course, we don't shy away from difficult conversations.
We report about disruption and how the latest technology and innovation have changed the way we live.
We told stories about crisis, but also about opportunities that came with it.
This is the Philippines.
And we are KNC.
At a time when we are gripped by fear, we are inspired by your courage. At a time when we are in dire need of hope, we look up to your sense of duty and compassion. At a time when the default reaction is self-preservation, you put the needs of the sick above your own. All those who are in the front lines of this pandemic. Thank you.
What do you like about it?
And I'm Nikki De Guzman.
Join us as we give you the rundown, the news you need to know today.
In the headlines, Philippine Vice President Lenny Robredo to run for president in 2022 as an independent candidate. We discuss this and other election developments with analyst Edna Ho and Gene Franco later on the program.
Will anyone else join the already crowded presidential race? We'll find out today on the last day of the filing of certificates of candidacy for the 2022 poll. The International Criminal Court's prosecutor vows to uncover the truth and ensure accountability in its formal investigation of the Duterte administration's bloody drug war. And world food prices hit a 10-year peak. Philippine Vice President Lenny Robredo heeds calls to seek the country's highest post in 2022. She filed her candidacy Thursday, just hours after announcing she will run for president. Her decision comes after a series of talks with other presidential aspirants in a quest to unite opposition forces against the Duterte administration for next year's polls.
Buong-buo ang loob ko ngayon. Kailangan nating palayain ang sarili mula sa kasalukuyang sitwasyon. Lalaban ako. Lalaban tayo. Inihahain ko ang aking sarili bilang kandidato sa pagkapangulo sa halalan ng 2022. Handa dapat tayong iwakse ng buong buo ang mga agenda, ang mga interes, ang mismong mga tao at klase ng politika na sanhi ng pinagdaraanan ng bansa natin ngayon.
In a surprise move, Robredo registered as an independent candidate. Although she continues to chair the Liberal Party, she even traded her party's signature yellow campaign color for blue and pink.
I don't think even her closest advisors knew that she will run as independent. She kept that very much close to her chest. even the day she would file and the day she will announce was her own personal decision. And because it allows her to continue all of her unification talks without being bogged down to just one party. It allows her to be seen as almost like a statesman woman rather than just pushing for the what is beneficial to just one group. And I think that's a very, very powerful position to be in.
Robredo has yet to announce who her running mate will be. But multiple sources confirmed to ABS-CBN News that Liberal Party President Senator Kiko Pangilinan, was chosen to be Robredo's vice president. Meanwhile, former Senator Bam Aquino is dropping his re-election bid to be Robredo's campaign manager. Other presidential contenders are seemingly unfazed by Vice President Robredo's move to join the race to Malacañang. For the late dictator's son, Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos Jr., whom Robredo defeated in the 2016 vice presidential race, her candidacy gives people more choices.
Expected naman lang. It's not surprising. Hindi nakakagulat. Dahil yun na nga, sinasabi, matagal na niya sinasabi, na matatakbo din siya. It doesn't work the other way. Hindi ko naiintindi. So, para sa akin, alam mo yung maraming kandidato. Maganda yan para maraming pagpipilihan ng tao.
The campaign manager of Isko Moreno says the Manila mayor's presidential run will push through even after the hashtag #WithdrawIsko trended on Twitter following Robredo's declaration. As for the camp of Senator Manny Pacquiao, it says there will be no change in their campaign strategy. It adds they already knew Robredo was going to throw her hat in the ring. Senator Panfilo Lacson, meanwhile, refused to comment on political rivals.
And we have now come to the final day of the filing of certificates of candidacy for the 2022 polls. Our correspondent, Jackie Pascual, is there outside the Comelec Filing Center in Pasay City, and he joins us live for an update. Jackie, what more can you tell us?
Good morning, Mike. That's you right. It's the last day of the filing of the certificate of candidacy for the upcoming 2022 elections. COMELEC is all ready and prepared to receive the COCs or the certificates of candidacies from those who wanted to run for the elections for the national positions here at Sofitel in Pasay. And so far, Mike, the situation here, at least outside the Sofitel Hotel, situation is still normal. It's still quiet and peaceful. As you can see behind me, there's just a few joggers and a few vloggers are here as well to record the happenings today. But we're expecting a lot of people later to file their COCs. And comparing to previous days, we are also expecting a lot of supporters to troop to the CCP complex, because the last few days there have been there's a motorcade of supporters and several people here in the area. Anti-riot police are now on standby here at Vicente Soto Street near PICC. They are expected to form a barricade once more people troop to the area. Supporters are only allowed until the orange cones and barriers, and they can't enter, move forward near the hotel, at least when the opening of the certifying begins later at 8 a.m. So, Mike, it's just less than an hour to go before the filing or the start of the filing of the COCs. And here, just outside the hotel, the Sofitel Hotel in Pasay, we are expecting more supporters and aspirants to troop here to this area, because this is the only entrance going to the hotel, and we will be monitoring the developments here today for the last day of the filing of COC for Halalan 2022. Mike, back to you.
Jackie, any word on any high-profile candidates or any high-profile personality who might still file their COCs today?
Yes, Mike, we've received word that the first around 8 o'clock, 8 to 9 a.m., Senator Laila De Lima will file her COC for a senator through a representative. And, of course, the running mate of Vice President Lenny Robredo, the expected running mate, Senator Kiko Pangilinan, who is expected to run for vice president, is also possibly going to file his certificate of candidacy this morning. And there are also a lot of senators who are expected to file for their COCs today, and of course, a lot more party-list. So far, for party-list groups, we've already the Comelec has already received almost 200 COCs for senators, almost 100 senators. So that number will certainly go up today. And that's the latest, Mike. Back to you.
Thank you for that update, Jackie Pascual. Meanwhile, Vice President Robredo's ally, human rights lawyer Chel Jocno, also filed his COC Thursday, formalizing his 2022 senatorial bid. This is his second attempt at a Senate seat. He ran in 2019 as part of the opposition slate Ocho Derecho, but failed to make the magic 12. Jocno believes he has a better chance of winning this time around, having learned from his earlier campaign.
I do agree that criticizing the government on its own is not going to bring much votes. It will probably capture the camp that is already supporting the opposition, but it's not going to widen the voting base. This time, number one, we have to emphasize the shared values of all Filipinos. Number two, we must demonstrate the dissonance with what is happening today and then provide hope for the future. Because that is what I believe the voting public is really looking for. And that's really what we all want.
More big names in Philippine politics registered as senatorial bets the day before the deadline for the filing of candidacies. Former Vice President and six-term Makati City Mayor Jejo Marabinay is making a political comeback after losing in his 2016 presidential bid. Binay filed his COC for senator. Also trying their luck for Senate seats, former Bayan Muna Representative Neri Colmenares and former House Speaker Alan Peter Cayetano. Former Defense Chief Gilbert Chadoro, who is also eyeing a seat in the upper chamber, filed his COC via proxy after contracting COVID-19. Chadoro is running under the People Reform Party of the late Senator Miriam Defensor Santiago.
Joining us this morning to talk more about this are Professor Edna Ko, the Director of UP in Clark and Olongapo, and a former Dean of the UP National College of Public Administration and Governance, and Associate Professor Jean Franco of the UP Political Science Department. Good morning, Professors Ko and Franco. Thank you so much for waking up early to join us this morning.
Good morning, Mike.
Good morning, Nikki.
Good morning, Nikki.
Good morning.
Now, we have lots to talk about this morning, but let me begin with Professor Ko. Did you anticipate Vice President Lenny Robredo eventually deciding to run for president? Because a few weeks ago, you indicated she was more likely to go local.
Well, actually, everybody, not just myself, was kind of put, we were walking on a tiptoe. Will she? Won't she? It was, everybody was guessing whether she will or she won't. But as we get closer to the date of the filing of candidacy, I got this strange feeling, and the drumming from the air just sounded like she was going to run. Her retreat to her hometown was an indication that she was making a very strong decision, a very serious decision. And I thought that was the clue. That was the cue that she'll come up with a very bombastic, a very major declaration. And she did yesterday. So now we put a period to the question mark. We put we clinch the statement now.
All right. Now, how about you, Dr. Franco or Professor Franco? Did you foresee Vice President Lenny eventually running? Because she did acknowledge in her speech that she did not intend to run. So what was it that made her run, in your opinion?
Well, she said a while back that she was running if Bongbong Marcos was running. So she fulfilled her statement a few weeks ago.
Mm-hmm. But was it merely just Bongbong Marcos' running? Because I know that in her speech, she did mention, she referred to candidates not being clear about their position on certain issues. And was that a reference to Manila Mayor Isko Moreno?
I guess her running, as I said before, sends a very strong signal that we have an opposition. Our democracy is vibrant.
Mm-hmm. And what do you make of how VP Leni presented herself yesterday? From the content of the speech to how she delivered it, was it a strong speech in your opinion?
Yeah, I thought it was a very powerful speech. She alluded to the nation by using the family as a metaphor, and she framed herself as a nanay who is fighting for the family, which is the nation. And all of us have mothers, so I think that was a good start.
Mm-hmm. How about you, Professor Ko? Do you think VP Leni's speech was effective? Because first, she discussed why she was running. There were portions where she mentioned the pandemic. She hit the incompetence of the current administration. And of course, as Dr. Franco mentioned, reference to being a mother or nana. And finally, a call to stand together. Your thoughts?
Actually, what was prevailing in my mind when she made her declaration was she solved the many questions that people were raising before yesterday. And that was decisiveness. She overturned the many comments about her indecision, her tiptoeing. And yesterday in her speech, she certainly was beyond a woman, beyond a mother. She was a leader to me. The leader is someone who makes the clear decision, heading on and being prepared for what is to come and what is to face for. And to me, that was very clear in her statement. I mean, this is a decisiveness. It was like, but also the character of strength. Because just like in a telenovela or in a drama or in a film, where here is a person who was from day one of her being vice president, she was relegated to the margins, deprived of major position and power and resources. Here she comes with a vengeance to say, we will have to stand together. And that to me, again, is a sign of leadership, having to rally behind, symbolizing someone who can rally people around her and say, let us stand together and we will head on and face the challenges. So to me, mother, woman, leader.
And how about the way she delivered it? Because, of course, that's a prepared speech. Because normally, if you look at her, if you watch her in her interviews, there are some mannerisms in the way she speaks that kind of some observers would say would indicate tentativeness or indecisiveness. But none of that in yesterday's speech. Do you think that was a deliberate attempt on her part to really be a more firm and appear resolute in the face of this campaign? No.
Actually, in many interviews prior, her statements were commented on by some people to be a bit repetitive, repeating some phrases. But this time, yesterday, it was very short, brief, one word, one phrase, but very strong. And I think that was well prepared, that was well thought out. The power of language was there. And it was a different Leni Robredo I saw in terms of delivering her speech and putting into words a very crucial and key decision in her life and in the nation's life.
Now, also interesting is that VP Leni did not wear yellow this time. Instead, she wore blue with a pink ribbon. Do you think using pink and blue will be effective? And is it too late to actually shed off the yellow tag?
Sorry.
Yes, go ahead, Dr. Ko.
Well, actually, if everybody realizes it, the color of the Liberal Party is blue and yellow. I think the yellow was shed off because of the moniker Dilawan. And I think the character of being a liberal minded woman is still there in her. She carries the blue part, but not the yellow part. But on the other hand, the pink, I think, is quite interesting. It's very attractive. Everybody was talking about pink. Yesterday, the air was about pink. And I thought that was very wise. well thought out, I would say, that the two colors, the blue and the pink, is already a statement of inclusivity, of embracing, of going beyond the yellow. I think that's the word. It's going beyond the yellow. It's being blue. It's not being yellow. It's blue and pink and everyone. So it's a color of inclusivity. And that's another brand which was very smart.
Professor Pro.
Ma'am ko, if I may just ask, what do you think about her getting Bam Aquino as her campaign manager? Do you think the support of the Aquinos would matter at this point, these 2022 elections? Or is it purely a strategic move?
Well, I think I will give respect to the Sambayan Coalition, because from what Brother Armin said, it was discussed in the Sambayan Coalition that Senator Bam Aquino would handle the campaign. But if you will ask me, it should not be centered on the senator, with my due respect to Senator Bam. I think there can be a whole group of people, and I'm sure they will consider that, a whole group of people, maybe more inclusive, not simply representing the Liberal Party, but if there is really a coalition campaign, it should really be a coalition, a team that should work around the campaign or behind the presidential bet.
Let me just go back to Professor Franco and going back to the topic of the choice of the color yellow. Now, was that choice moving away from yellow, the color most identified with Aquino's and Liberal Party, and her decision to run as an independent candidate, this is a deliberate move to veer away from the Dilawan versus DDS narrative?
Yes, I think that is really the case. As Dr. Ko said earlier, this is part of Lenny's rebranding. She wants to be more inclusive in her statements and in her public persona and in her platform of governance. And, you know, considering what she is up to, I think this is a good start. No, she has to veer away from the Dilawan narrative because this did not win them votes in the 2019 elections.
Mm-hmm. And how about the choice of Senator Keiko Pangilinan as VP Lenny's running mate? Do you think this is a strategic move?
I guess so, because Senator Keiko Pangilinan has been a senator for a long time. He has a lot of laws passed. He performed very well as a senator for the longest time already. And I think he will bring vigor and enthusiasm. It will be a major boost to VP Lenny's candidacy.
And Professor Ko, if VP Lenny wanted to move away from the Liberal Party, why choose a stalwart of the Liberal Party like Senator Pangilinan?
Exactly a question in my mind, that if one was to be the candidate of all and for all. But as I understand the coalition, I think they are going to tackle the matter today, that they will eventually, finally, this is the last day of filing of candidacy, they will decide again. Very quickly, but I hope thoroughly, to consider inclusivity and the broadness really of the representation in the carrier of the Sambayan Coalition. But I think the name of Keiko Pangilinan was included in the list, but there's a good long list of other possibilities as well. So I think we will see at the end of the day today whether it is indeed another a Liberal Party stalwart who will be behind VP Lenny.
For both of you, how do you think VP Lenny's announcement will affect her standing in the presidential surveys? Will we see a rise in her ranking? Professor Franco.
Yeah, I guess definitely it was yesterday was kind of a major boost in her all the doubts, all the the tiptoeing and the dilly-dallying that were perceived to be a part of her being indecisive proved to be wrong. No, and I think it is going to be a good start for her in the run-up to the 2022 elections.
Professor Ko, on social media, we saw actually a lot of posts in pink, a reference to her choice of color. But do you think this is just the echo chamber that we're in? How, do you think this will go beyond social media and extend to the masses, to the population outside social media?
I think there was some kind of a semi-euphoria yesterday. You felt it in the air. It was all over social media. And the number was really astounding of those who were jubilant about the declaration of VP Leni. And I think that was a result of an expression of hope, an expression that finally we wanted to hear from her. And finally, she made a declaration and people were so joyous about it. I think that's one thing. But in the coming days, things will have to unfold and we'll see how things go. Again, it is important how VP Leni and the campaign team would some sort of very smartly sustain the energy that was manifested yesterday. I think your question earlier, from day one, I was saying, I am not someone who believes entirely or strongly on the survey, because the survey is about a particular point in time. At the time when she has no statement, that she has no declaration, that she showed hesitancy to run, I expected that she's not going to come rise up in the survey. Because if you're a regular voter, I think we have to look at it from the point of view of a voter as well. If I'm a voter, I would say, well, who's available anyway? And if even if I like X person, but doesn't make herself present or available, I have to look elsewhere and to explore other possibilities. I think that's human nature. And therefore, when she declared yesterday, I think that personally, we will expect people to have a stronger indication of support for someone who makes herself available.
Now let's talk about the effect of her running on other candidates. Because yesterday, we saw the hashtag Withdraw Isko trending. Manila Mayor Isko Moreno's Cap declined to comment on that. But why do you think, of all the candidates, Isko was the one the VP Leni supporters are asking to withdraw, Professor Franco?
Well, maybe because of the belief by some sectors that it's too early for Isko. He is relatively young with little experience. And some people might want him to be the vice presidential candidate of Leni. So I guess it's part of the campaign to, you know, to discredit some people, some candidates that disappointed some portion of the electorate.
Mm-hmm. And Professor Ko, do you see the likelihood of any of the other candidates giving way for VP Leni? And if so, who among them would likely be the one to give way?
I am still hopeful that things can be sorted out between among candidates. And we cannot discount the possibility of some candidates who, despite filing, can bend backward and say, all right, let's move together, let's have unity. There's a long period of time between now and November 15. So I think that's the reason that VP Leni was saying she doesn't give up on unifying and collaborating with other candidates. I think there is such a long time. And if you know the Pinoy psychology, sometimes we are surprised by such instant changing of mind. And so we cannot discount that possibility, especially if there are indications that there is popular support, there is an increasing support for an ex-candidate. I think conversations will be more open.
Mm-hmm. Talk about changing of the mind. How about the likelihood of Davao City Mayor Sara Duterte still running for president? Because we've seen supporters mobilizing on social media, calling on her to run, but she said she won't. So is there still a chance that she will run, Professor Franco?
Just last night, there was a strong buzz that she's in Manila and she's going to file her candidacy today. We don't know whether that's true or not, but to the extent that this is still being talked about, then we are still on a guessing game, no? If she runs, no? You know, this is just like a chess game, no? So to speak. And if she runs, it's going to really change the entire field. And it's, once again, it's more fun in the Philippines.
Right. And Professor Ko, yesterday I saw, or actually last night, I saw on social media a photo of an eagle projected on the facade of the Davao City Hall. But it turned out that this was an old photo. So what does this say about the psyche of Mayor Duterte's supporters? Is this an indication of desperation or an earnest belief that she should run for president?
I think that the Duterte's have been bringing us wonderment, surprises. And therefore, it is very difficult to predict, difficult to tell. Something you imagine they won't do, but they are able to do, surprisingly. And therefore, until the last day, the last hour today, we will never know until the... we are filled with surprises. But the other surprise is that there can be so many changes between now and November 15.
Mm-hmm. And one of that possibility, there's also the possibility of Mayor Duterte running for vice president. But if she does not run for president, who do you think will benefit from it? Is it former Senator Bongbong Marcos? Because they're saying the supporters of the Dutetes and the Marcoses do have some commonalities. So what do you think, Professor Ko?
I think that's not impossible that the winner or the gainer, not the winner, but the gainer of such, withdrawal from the presidential bet is Bongbong Marcos. And I think it is almost public and everybody knows that... They do support each other and they make a very the best of allies. However, for people who there may be some section of that supporting group who can also consider other options, but by and large, I think at this point it will be difficult to automatically imagine that the choice for Sara could automatically go to Bongbong Marcos. You have a woman here who stood a little bit different from the older Duterte, and therefore that spells a bit of a change, which some people would like. But if you pull out that possibility of a little change, will I go to someone who has not been visible, who has been underperforming in the last 5 years? We've never heard of him in the last 5 years. So how can I automatically switch there? So it should be someone who could probably equally popular or visible. And therefore, if I was someone who was supporting Sara and she did not push through, I would consider someone else closer to that. Probably a woman, probably someone who would stand for change, someone who will be different, really a little bit, the range of difference will matter, but it is not likely, it is not automatic that the Sara support vote would automatically go to Bongbong Marcos.
How about you, Dr. Franco? How important is it to have unity talks, especially if Sara does not run?
It is very important. We are in a pandemic and we need to move forward. We need to know how this will end and whether the economy will recover in the coming years. And for the candidates, I think in the end, their love of country should be stronger than their ambitions.
Mm-hmm. And right. Just to end, we all know that Vice President Lenny did beat Bongbong Marcos the first time around when they both ran for VP. No? So what would make Bongbong Marcos actually harder to beat now? And is he really the candidate to beat?
Bongbong Marcos has a huge amount of resources and she has spent, his camp has spent a considerable amount of time, and resources revising history. And that in itself tells you that he still has a very powerful name.
Mm-hmm. What about you, Ma'am Ko?
Oh, Nikki, I think I look at election always. We tend to look at personalities during election. We tend to look more at the candidates. But I think I'd like to invite everyone to please have a look at the voters. And at this point in the election, where the champions are really the voters, I think the clamor of the voters is a change. I mean, from what we've been through economically, life, livelihood, our own safety, and even gotten worse during the pandemic, we don't want to be in the same situation. And therefore, the call for a change. And I think that's everyone's aspiration. The rich, the middle class, the poor, who will all cast their votes, are clamoring for a change. So I would look for someone who could be my passport to that so-called change. We want to get out of this situation. We want someone who can lead us and who I can identify with for change. And come on, the voters are the stars during election. And I think all the more that we have to pay attention to the voters' clamor rather than to the sterling personalities, which can really be overwhelming, confusing, cheating in a way, no? You don't see really who's who until you see the performance when one sits in office. But certainly there's quite a lot of things to do in terms of informing, getting the aspiration higher up above us all. So this is what Dr. Franco said. What is important is, what do we aspire for as a country, as a people? Let's get down to the voters. And they spell on their faces change.
Mm-hmm. Agreed, right. Ma'am Ko, Ma'am Franco, Mike.
All right. On that note, thank you so much for a very interesting discussion this morning, Professor Edna Ko and Professor Jean Franco, both from the University of the Philippines.
Thank you, Mike. Thank you, Nikki.
Bye.
All right. In other news, veteran ABS-CBN News anchor Noli De Castro sets his sights on a political comeback. The former Philippine vice president is set to run for the Senate, where he once served from 2001 to 2004 before joining former President Gloria Arroyo as her running mate. De Castro took his oath Thursday as a member of Aksyon Demokratiko, the party of Manila Mayor and presidential bet Isko Moreno. The broadcaster is more popularly known as Kabayan, returned to ABS-CBN in 2010, at the end of his vice presidential term. He bid goodbye Thursday to the audience of ABS-CBN's primetime newscast, TV Patrol.
Masakit man na magpaalam sa programang minahal ko at naging buhay ko. At sa mahabang samahan sa mga kapamilya sa ABS-CBN, ako'y humaharap sa mga hamon sa panibagyong yugto sa aking buhay. Sa huling pagkakataon po, iiwan namin sa inyo ang salamat po at magandang gabi! Bayan.
Now here's a look at other stories that we are tracking today. Vice President and presidential aspirant Lenny Robredo will hold a press conference at 11 a.m. where she is expected to announce who her running mate will be.
And Dr. Marilyn Padlan of the One Hospital Command Center will be on the Laging Handa public briefing for an update on hospital occupancy rates in the Philippines amid the COVID pandemic.
And we are taking a quick break. Up ahead, the International Criminal Court's prosecutor reiterates it has the authority to probe Philippine President Duterte's bloody drug war.
And world food prices hit a 10-year peak. News and more with the Rundown returns. Stay tuned.
mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
Welcome back to The Rundown. The headlines across the web, Inquirer's banner story online. The ICC vows for an independent and impartial probe on the Philippines' human rights situation. Philippine Star Stop Story pilot test for face-to-face classes may also be done in the National Capital Region should COVID cases continue to decline. Manila Bulletin's headline, Vice President Lenny Robredo deciding to gun for the country's top post. Topping GMA News' website, UN Human Rights Chief calls on the government to make the drug war probe findings public.
The Philippines logged 10,000 new COVID infections Thursday, bringing the tally to 2,632,000. 115,000 of these are active cases. The health department also confirmed 109 new fatalities after 2 days of not being able to update the COVID death toll due to problems with its data collating system. The agency says it will report more fatalities today to reflect numbers not included in previous bulletins.
Philippine Health Secretary Francisco Duque questions the country's poor ranking in Nikkei Asia's latest COVID-19 recovery index. The Philippines was ranked last among 121 countries due to a low COVID vaccination rate. But Duque insists the country's inoculation drive is not doing badly, saying vaccinations are now close to 30% of the government's 70% target.
Pinag-aaralan natin dahil unang-una, yung they're comparing apples and oranges. Yung mga bansa na in-assess nila, wala nang surge. Samantalang tayo, pababa pa lang. Kung cumulative yung ginawa nilang pagsusuri, we would have scored higher.
The government's Pandemic Task Force Chief Carlito Galvez also doubts the accuracy of the Nikkei Index ranking. He likewise disagrees with the recent Bloomberg report, which also gave the Philippines' COVID response a low rating.
Yung Nikkei at saka yung Bloomberg, they are all business-oriented. Hindi nila binasihan yung tinatawag natin yung debt. Yung ating debt rate is only 1.5-1.7. Ang karamihan sa global natin is 2.3. Mali yung kanilang ginagawang sistema ng analysis.
The International Criminal Court reiterates it has authority over alleged crimes against humanity in the Philippines, despite the country's withdrawal from the intergovernmental organization. ICC Prosecutor Karim Khan says judges of the ICC pre-trial chamber confirmed that his office retains jurisdiction on its probe on the war on drugs in the Philippines. From July 2016, when President Rodrigo Duterte took office, until March 16, 2019, when the country's withdrawal took effect. The probe will also cover the vigilante killings in Davao City from when Duterte served as mayor and vice mayor. Khan says the investigation will seek to uncover the truth to ensure accountability with the aim of bringing justice to victims and affected communities. He adds he is willing to cooperate with Philippine authorities on the probe. Malacañang, Jaguar.
The United Nations Human Rights Office urges the Philippine government to publish the findings of its drug war review panel. UN High Commissioner for Human Rights Michelle Bachelet says while the Philippine Justice Department's drug war review is an initial development in its joint initiative with the UN, the DOJ's work must be publicized so it can be evaluated. In February, a Philippine Department of Justice-led panel referred its findings on 52 cases involving 154 police officers for investigation for criminal liability. Bachelet also urges the Philippine government to involve the Commission on Human Rights and other relevant agencies in its drug war review. The DOJ has said the CHR will be involved in the next phase. World food prices rose for a second consecutive month in September, reaching a 10-year high. United Nations Agency Food and Agriculture Organization said the increase was driven by gains in cereals and vegetable oils. The food price index averaged 130 points last month from 128.5 in August. On a year-to-year basis, food prices were up 32.8% in September. The group also projected record global cereal production this year, but said it would be outpaced by forecast consumption.
Back here at home, the Philippine Education Department reminds schools participating in the pilot run of limited in-person learning to prepare a contingency plan should there be an outbreak of COVID cases. This amid concerns on the safety of teachers and students who will take part in the pilot implementation. DepEd Secretary Leonor Briones reiterates participation in the pilot test is not required. The limited face-to-face classes will start on November 15. And Knowledge Channel has returned to digital TV, making its educational programs available again in areas such as Baguio, Naga, Iloilo, Davao, and Zamboanga. Viewers can access Knowledge Channel via Beam DTT by simply doing a channel rescan on any digital TV box. For more on their new offerings, we are joined by Edric Calma. He's the Director of Operations at Knowledge Channel. Good morning, Sir Edric. Thank you for joining us.
Good morning, Nikki. Good morning po, mga kapamilya.
So, sir, can you tell us more about your return to digital TV? Give us a rundown of your new offerings, your current show lineup, the age ranges that you cater to.
This is very good news for us, Nikki. No? Last year, when the government did not grant the renewal of franchise to ABS-CBN, we lost hundreds of thousands and even millions of households watching Knowledge Channel through our ABS-CBN TV Plus and Sky Direct. And so for a while, we were down to, let's say, whatever the coverage of Sky Cable then was. But then, because of... we partnered with cable operators, we partnered with direct-to-home services all over the country. Our reach grew to around 5 million. But now, with DTT, with Beam, where I think we will be reaching 10 million households this time. So it's really good news for all of us. So that more learners, more parents, more teachers mm-hmm. would have access to the program, to the shows that we have on Knowledge Channel. You know, all the programs, all the videos that we show are all based on the curriculum of the Department of Education. And we show them at the time that they need that based on the curriculum. So we follow the schedule of classes for the different grade levels for the different subjects.
All right. And could you expound again on how we can access your channel and where else can we watch your shows?
For those people who have the ABS-CBN TV Plus, those that they thought they could not be used anymore, but now they could scan. They could try out turning it on and scan and look for Knowledge Channel, especially in the areas of Baguio, NCR, Iloilo, Metro Cebu, Davao, and Zamboanga, and Naga. And for those with access to internet, we're online on knowledgechannel.org and iWantTFC. And of course, we're on Sky and the other... We are being carried by 400 plus cable operators all over the country and Signal as well, GSAT and Satellite.
Mm-hmm. And how can parents and teachers use your materials to enrich their students at home?
Yes, that's a nice question. Whatever we're showing are the things that are that your kids are learning with their modules. So whatever the lesson for the week is, that's what we're showing on Knowledge Channel. So all that they have to do is to go to the website, look for the for our program grade and make their kids watch. You know, ask the kids to watch before looking at their learning with their modules or after looking at their modules. So everything is in sync, you know, with the Dep Ed schedule of work and the topics.
Definitely a more interesting way to learn, no?
Yes, definitely.
So can you tell us more about your Stay at Home, Learn at Home campaign that you launched last year? How does your return to digital TV impact this cause?
You know what? Last year, as soon as we found out that the schools wouldn't be opening in June and that kids would be learning at home, we launched a School at Home. It's a campaign for kids, the teachers and parents to just stay at home. Don't go out and just watch Knowledge Channel every day, every single day, and watch the and learn with the videos that we have. So again, with the modules that they have, they just have to tune into Knowledge Channel every day. And then as they read the modules, siguro watch the Knowledge Channel videos or before looking at their modules, watch the Knowledge Channel. We have been producing a lot of materials. Last school year, we were able to produce hundreds of materials, new videos for reading for grade one. And we are still producing a lot of materials this year, you know. And we hope to produce even more in the coming months. And what's good with the videos that we show on Knowledge Channel is that we have matched with each of the learning competencies that are required by the Department of Education. So for each of the competencies and the most essential learning competencies, the new curriculum guide that they're implementing this school year, we have a corresponding video for each of the competencies. So it makes learning so much easier for them. So manood ka lang, basa ka lang ng modules, and that's it. You would be learning much, much better than those who just read with them or learn with the modules.
Mm-hmm, that's really good to know. Now, Edric, do you have a website we can visit or social media accounts that we can reach for more educational materials as well as the latest updates?
Yes, thank you for asking that question. We're on knowledgechannel.org. Knowledgechannel.org is the website of the Knowledge Channel. Our videos are there. Whatever we're showing on air, our videos are there. We're also on I1TFC and Just Love Kids of ABS-CBN. We're also on YouTube. KnowledgeChannel.org. So we're online, we're on air, and we're also offline for some schools who've purchased or who have gotten hold of our portable media library. We're also online for offline for areas without access to TV and the internet.
All right. On that note, thank you so much for joining us this morning, Edric. You stay.
Thank you. Good morning.
Meanwhile, the U.S. eyes vaccinating children by November as Pfizer seeks to expand the emergency authorization for its COVID vaccine to 5 to 11-year-olds. That story and more from our North America correspondent, Penny Espinosa.
Good morning, Mike and Nikki. Here are the latest stories making headlines amongst the Filipino community. A big boost could be on the way for the Biden administration in their efforts to get more and more Americans vaccinated against COVID-19. As pharmaceutical giant Pfizer and BioNTech have asked U.S. regulators to approve emergency use of their COVID-19 vaccine for children aged 5 to 11. White House COVID-19 Response Coordinator Jeff Sines told CNN the vaccine for young children could be ready to roll out as early as November. The FDA set a date of October 26 for its panel of outside advisors to meet and discuss the Pfizer-BioNTech application. It's possible for kids to begin receiving the vaccine shortly afterwards. With 27% of all U.S. COVID cases coming from children, according to the American Academy of Pediatrics, there's a growing concern of another spike come in the fall. A swift FDA approval could help mitigate a potential surge of cases with schools already open nationwide. Over in New Jersey, the Byram Township Detective Bureau is investigating a prominent Filipino couple for allegedly endangering their clients and supposed deceptive business practices at the Claremont Adult Daycare Center. The probe was initiated in June after a Byram Township construction official conducting a routine inspection of the facility found there were 9 elderly adults who appeared to have dementia. The owners, Fe Martinez Coliolo and Rolando David, were charged with the following: for housing the elderly in what the Bureau describes as an unlicensed facility, endangering the welfare of an incompetent person, causing or risking widespread injury, deceptive business practices. In a phone call with TFC News, Faye Martinez Colyolo denied any wrongdoing, but said she was advised by her lawyers not to comment at this time while the investigation is ongoing. And down in Los Angeles, where Marlon the Nightmare Tapales continues his world champion dreams. The 29-year-old Tapales has been training stateside since August and is scheduled for a November 27 eliminator match against Japan's Hiroaki Teshigawara in Las Vegas. With a record of 34-3 and 17 knockouts, this next match is another chance for him to get back on the top of the division.
Sobrang importante talaga to sa akin yung laban na to kasi kumbaga ito rin yung isa pang chance ako, pangalawang chance ako na to sa eliminator. Dati natalo ko, ngayon pinagsisikapan ko talaga na manalo ko.
And those were the latest headlines from North America. You can catch our stories online at news.abs-cbn.com/TFC News and on the ABS-CBN News YouTube channel. Back to Mike and Nikki for the rundown.
Thank you, Henny. Let's now talk to Ms. Karen Davila for today's guest on Head Start. Good morning, Ms. Karen.
Good morning, Ms. Karen.
Good morning,
happy
Mike
Friday.
And Nikki. It's a happy Friday, and it's been a while since we chatted. Didn't you notice?
Yes.
We did.
I know, but TGIF, it's Friday. So this morning on Head Start, we are going to have Secretary Carlito Galvez to update us. What is the status of inoculation in the country? Will we reach herd immunity by December? And also these COVID resilience rankings that actually put the Philippines below compared to all these countries that have been surveyed. And later on, we have an expert from Globe Telecom who will be explaining what happened. How can that be done? The BBM alerts that actually shocked many people at the Sofitel a few days ago.
Mm-hmm. And perhaps as a former general, Secretary Galvez can also weigh in if he has knowledge about this device that was supposedly used.
Yeah, that's a good one, Mike. Yeah.
And perhaps updates on the pediatric vaccinations?
You know, that's a good point because, I mean, I have a 13-year-old and as a family, we're already asking, when will that happen in the Philippines? Thanks for that, Nikki.
All right. So we will be watching the interview with Secretary Galvez later on Head Start. Thank you, Ms. Karen. And that's the rundown today. I'm Mike Navalio. You can watch highlights, recaps, and exclusive content of our shows online.
And I'm Nikki De Guzman. Subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel. Like us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter. Head Start comes your way next. Stay with ANC.
In this episode, find out what it's like to live and let die like 007 by getting behind a wheel of his favorite cars, firing the guns that eliminate the villains, flying the planes that save the day. We'll dress like Bond with his preferred choice of wristwatch and tailor-made tux. Sip martinis like he does and follow his trail around the world.